the British are going to dim the sun and make more clouds to stop catastrophic climate change, and some Brits are not happy.
Obviously, we only have the authority to dim the sun over England, which, again, is such a preposterous thing to say.
And they've even announced that they're going to do some experiments here in Australia to change our climate, especially on the Great Barrier Reef. And some of our fish and coral are not happy either.
Who the hell do you think you are? I do not consent to you blocking out the sun. Absolutely mad.
No, I mean it. They've just funded a $2 million experiment to make clouds on the Great Barrier Reef. Just been announced. I can't believe it. It's the same mob that I criticised so strongly in my last video. Anyway, does this work to change the clouds? Is it really such a bad idea? The motivation is certainly a bit crazy, but actually, if the $100 million they're going to spend was focused in the right areas, it could actually do some good. By accident, because, well, it could help us understand clouds in the role of climate, something which is horribly understood, as we'll see in a minute. So I think the British should sacrifice themselves. After all, nobody's better able to deal with a lack of sun than the Brits because, well, they've had more practice than anybody else. As Carl Benjamin says, Britain gets less sun than almost everywhere else on Earth.
As you can see, the only places that get fewer sunlight hours than us are in the Arctic Circle.
So from this map, which shows the number of hours of sunlight, almost everywhere gets far more sun than Pommyland. So it's a bit ironic that the British are doing this research. And it's all written down in quite a succinct report by a group called ARIA, UK's Advanced Research Invention Agency. Now, there was a day when the British invented things like steam engines and jet engines and radar and the first electronic computers and all sorts of medical advances such as antibiotics and CAT scanners. And nowadays, their Advanced Research Invention Agency is going to try to change the climate because England is too hot and sunny. And they propose to do it in three ways. Firstly, by making clouds over the sea brighter to reflect the sun, basically firing salt into the air over the sea. My last video mentioned this insanity. The second is putting reflectors into space to dim the sun. Or they can reduce the amount of high-level cirrus clouds. These are the wispy ones very high up. Doing things like injecting non-toxic bismuth trioxide has been mentioned. And to be sure, they are barking mad if they think they're going to be allowed to do this. I mean, it is crazy that people living in one of the coldest, most miserable climates on Earth are going to be allowed by a bunch of deranged scientists to make it colder and more miserable. The British would revolt if they actually did this on a big scale.
The idea that this could go ahead and has been, apparently it's just going to be signed off by the Labour government, is just mad. Absolutely mad. And we will end up having to campaign.
And so would most other countries. And ARIA are just a little bit defensive about this. They say they are not funding any activities designed to block out the sun or carry out large-scale climate modifications. But actually, that is disingenuous, which is a polite word for total and utter BS, because that's precisely what the ultimate aim is, even if they're only going to be doing small experiments to start with. But on a small scale at which they will inevitably start to do the experiments, on a small scale, we could learn a whole lot about clouds. And clouds are one of the great imponderables, the great scientific mystery about our climate. Turns out that clouds reflect about 30% of the sun already, far more in England, obviously. And a little known thing is that clouds are, by and large, decreasing and have been for a few decades. We have satellite data going back to the early 1980s when it was about 63% cover and it's dropped to 61%. And if you look at this diagram, the 340 watts per square metre of sunlight radiation coming in, about 80 watts per square metre is reflected by the clouds, about 25%. So this change in clouds will have a change in the amount of radiation hitting the Earth of about 2 to 3 watts per square meter. Doesn't sound like much, but the contribution from doubling greenhouse gases is calculated also to be just a few watts per square meter. So it's equivalent. But the crucial thing is that we don't have any idea why the clouds have reduced in the last few decades. Was it caused by human climate change, or is it partially causing the climate change? Is it some natural fluctuation in clouds? Actually, we don't have a clue. So when some scientists say that we're sure that humans have caused the warming of climate over the last century, my response is, but we don't even understand fundamental things like clouds and how they've changed. So don't claim that we have complete understanding or anything close to that. And actually, even the measurements of cloud cover have a fair bit of scatter in them. Look at this graph, which shows the different methods of calculating the Earth's total cloud cover. Plenty of scatter there, but all showing a decline since the early 1980s. But this ARIA work could well, if they had any sense, focus on the high cirrus clouds, and they can warm the planet. So, for example, in a cold climate on a very clear day, well, that will be a cold day. If you get cirrus clouds, it will make things warmer. In the tropics, on the other hand, the high cirrus probably won't make a great deal of difference, but even that's a controversial statement, because there's very poor understanding even on the impacts of radiation. But even the cloud formation is not understood very well. Why in most clouds do the tiny water droplets not stick together, getting bigger and bigger, thus forming raindrop-sized drops which can fall out? The processes of collisions of the drops sometimes works very efficiently, sometimes not. I mean, just think about it. First, the cloud drops can't form until there is some particle to stick on, a bit of soot, a bit of salt, or whatever. The cloud condensation nuclei. But then why does that drop grow by sucking the water out of the air around it until it becomes a few microns in size? Well, we kind of understand that reasonably well, but then the next process of coalescence of those drops to form bigger drops, why do some collisions between the drops, they just bounce off like billiard balls, but other times the drops stick together and again until finally you've got a drop that is big enough to fall out as rain. In the big climate models, they use what's called parameterizations to do the necessary calculations with clouds. Parameterizations is a big scientific word saying, well, we'll do the best we can with a few guesses and whatever data we have, because we don't actually understand what's going on. Now, that's not a criticism, well, it is a bit, but I've used this exact process, it's a bodgy technique, lots of times in my own research. But don't pretend that it's very satisfactory, because it's actually an admission of ignorance. And it's not just important to understand cloud formation due to the way it reflects sunlight and reduces the outgoing infrared radiation. If your model does not calculate rain properly because it does not know how to do clouds properly, it cannot work out how much rain comes out of a cloud, then the model will calculate the wrong humidity of the atmosphere. It won't calculate the amount of water vapor, and water vapor is the main greenhouse gas, far more important than carbon dioxide. In fact, one of the main magnifying factors in catastrophic greenhouse theory, if you believe that, is that a warming climate should allow more water vapor, and water vapor is a greenhouse gas, so greenhouse effect gets amplified. But if you don't understand clouds properly, your model runs on rough parameterizations and may well be horribly wrong. And that's why I'm in favor of experimenting with clouds, all clouds, everywhere, high and low, even on the Great Barrier Reef. Provided you do the necessary micrometeorological measurements and the radiological measurements, which unfortunately much of what ARIA proposed seems to be missing. I could be wrong. And it's not like these scientists will do anything dangerous. They're not competent enough for that. I mean, I showed you this video last week. Here is their best effort to make clouds just offshore from here. Not very impressive. And as mentioned, ARIA and the British taxpayer has just handed over £1 million for these experiments on the reef. Thanks, Brits. I'm sure there was no better way to spend your money than on an experiment on a coral reef 10,000 miles away to protect an ecosystem that's in rude health. But anyway, In summary, clouds are one of the huge problems that make greenhouse models reasonably close to useless. ARIA won't be allowed to do this work on a big scale. Mind you, maybe I'm being a little bit too complacent, but the experiments might well have a serendipitous spin-off in our understanding of clouds if they concentrate on the right things. And that probably is a little bit of wishful thinking.